Happy Sabbath and welcome to the Community Praise Church virtual worship experience. We're thankful that we get to worship with you today on this Religious Liberty Sabbath. Of course, huge thank you to our Religious Liberty leader, Christina Zanotti. You and your team have put in so much care and concern into making this day possible, crafting this experience. So thank you for your leadership. Of course, we want to start by inviting the Holy Spirit to come and join us wherever we are in our different far-flung parts of the world as we worship this, and of course those who are worshiping right here in the DMV. So we just want to invite you to pause where you are, bow your heads to pray with us. God, we thank you for the liberty that you have afforded us. For your word says that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, there is freedom. So we ask that your Spirit join us here in this worship experience today. Bless each and every participant in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, I don't know about you, but I'm ready to jump into this worship experience. And I'm also really excited that I get to worship with you. Listen, I want to know what God has been doing in your life. What has God blessed you with in this week? How has God been faithful to you? Maybe it's just life, health, and strength. That's huge. Maybe God did something even more out of the norm for you. Maybe God just kept you safe on the highways and the byways, as they would say down south. Either way, I want to know what God has been doing in your life. So head on down to the comments and let me know what God has been doing for you so we can celebrate together. Listen, while you're down there, would you consider clicking that share button? Allow someone else to experience this worship with us. It's your way to serve as a digital evangelist. It's one way to contribute to the body of Christ. Another way for you to contribute to the body of Christ is to head over to cpcsda.org/give. There you can return your tithe and give a generous free will offering. I want to tell you this. God has placed a huge vision on the collective hearts of our leadership team here at CPC. There are no ifs, ands, or buts about it. The vision is huge. And one of the most important elements in accomplishing this vision that God has placed on the heart of our church leadership, one of the most important elements is your giving. By giving to this local church through your offerings, you allow for us to take this gospel message to the next level, to take it near and far, to tell someone somewhere about Jesus. That's what it's all about. And it's made possible through your giving and through God's grace. So thank you to everyone who is headed over to cpcsda.org/give and has chosen to give a generous free will offering to this local church. Thank you. Hey, it's Religious Liberty Sabbath, so we have a special program lined up for you. We have special guest artist John Stoddart with us today. A little bit later on, you'll hear from our CPC band led by our music director, Daryl Hunt. And of course, today you will hear a word from my really good friend and brother, Michael Nixon, who serves as the Vice President of Diversity and Inclusion at Andrews University. That's my guy, so I am so excited about that a little bit later on. But of course, you know, right now it's time for our children's story. So gather around, boys and girls. We're excited to jump on into this. It's your time. Again, God bless you and happy Sabbath.
Jesus and me, we are the best of friends. But Jesus and me. Jesus and me, we are the best of friends. Oh, he's there when I wake up. There when I wake up. There when I lie down. There when I lie down. There when I need him. There when ways around, but bum bum, Jesus and me, Jesus and me, we are the best of friends. But bum bum, Jesus and me, Jesus and me, we are the best of friends. Oh, we are the best of friends. Yes, we are the best of friends. Da-da.
Hi, I'm Zuri.
And I'm Zoe. Our story today is about self-control.
About 3 years ago, my sister and I were getting ready to go to the ice cream store. I was relaxing on the couch waiting for my mom and my sister. I was watching my iPad and I heard Zoe shouting, "Incoming!" down the stairs to let me know she was coming. I glanced at the corner of my screen and saw my iPad was on 4%. My hand reached around for the charger next to me and I plugged the charger into my iPad.
When I got to the couch, I saw Zuri watching Netflix, not doing anything, and I sat down on the couch, looking around for my charger that I had put next to a pillow. I saw that Zuri was using a charger and thought it was mine. For a couple of seconds, we went back and forth, arguing over whose charger it was.
Zoe launched a pillow at me, hoping it would shut me up. Without thinking about the effects of having a pillow fight in the living room, I threw it back at her and thus sent her falling onto the ground. I thought the argument was over, considering we sat in silence for a couple of minutes. But
boy, was she wrong. We went back and forth, throwing pillows playfully as hard as we could, hoping for the pillow to reach its target. And it was all fun and games until Zuri decided to throw a pillow at me. But instead of hitting the floor, my reflexes were quick and I batted it away from me, thinking I was safe.
But instead of the pillow hitting the floor, it hit my mom's glass vase that she got as a wedding gift. And it shattered onto the floor. Glass everywhere.
We looked at each other, terrified of what our mom would say and think. Our eyes wide with fear.
My heart sank. My hands grew sweaty. My mind spiraled out of control.
What if we got spanked? Or worse, what if she didn't take us to the ice cream store? Our mom instantly heard the loud crash and called to us, "What was that?" Zuri and I both froze in our steps and shouted back up at her, "Nothing!"
Zoe heard our footsteps and attempted to run to the bathroom, but didn't make it very far. My mom obviously didn't buy the nothing act and ran downstairs to see what happened.
When she got downstairs, she glanced at me and Zuri, and that's when she saw it.
Her glass vase laid on the floor by the window, and all I could think was all the trouble we were going to be in.
How bad was our punishment going to be? Would we still be getting ice cream? Then our mom's angry voice snapped us out of our thoughts and back into reality.
She asked what happened in a semi-angry tone, but with an upset look on her face. I wanted to lie, but I knew that if I did, I would probably get myself into more trouble than I already was in. So I decided to tell the truth. We were having a pillow fight in your living room, and we knocked over your vase.
Our mom stopped for a second and looked like she was having a fight inside her head, saying, "Let the children go, or make them stay and clean up all the glass."
I couldn't believe I was thinking this, but I actually wanted to stay and clean up all the glass because I deserved it. My mom looked up at us and smiled.
Get the vacuum and clean up this mess. We need to leave before the ice cream store closes. Why was she saying this, I thought, but before I could finish my thought, she added on,
and I'll finish you later. We did get to go to the ice cream store that day, but after our ice cream trip, we had to face the consequences of our actions.
In the Bible, God speaks to us about self-control. In Galatians 5:22-23, the verse says, and the Spirit gives love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
And in Proverbs 25:28, it says, a person who does not control himself is like a city whose walls have been broken down. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that we get the opportunity to learn about self-control. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. That's all for today. We'll
see you next week. Bye!
Good afternoon, CPC family. It's prayer time. This week has been a week of new beginnings, a week of transition. At the same time, it's been a week of challenge, a week of pain, a week of loss for not just people in our world, but people in our very own church. And our God is a God who gives comfort, who gives peace, a God who gives answers, a God who provides jobs, a God who gets us through school, a God who blesses our marriages, and a God above all, who promises that he will return. And so today, for just a few moments, I want you to gather with your friends and your family, get in front of your television, your tablet, your phone, wherever you are, as we seek the God of the universe today, the God who gives comfort, who gives counsel, the God of our redemption, the God of our creation. Let's bow our heads together for prayer. God, your grace is sufficient for us. Your love is enduring. Your power is overwhelming. This week, God, we've seen a week of transition, a week of new beginnings for many. But along with a week of new beginnings, it is a week of challenge. There are family members within our own context, our own congregation, who have lost loved ones. God, I pray that you would surround them with your holy angels, that Holy Spirit, you would give them comfort. There are people in our congregation right now, in my own community, Praise Church family, who are going through struggles in their marriages. No one knows, but in their marriage, it feels like a desolate wasteland. It feels like we're on two different islands. It feels like we can't connect. Our communication isn't strong. And I pray, Lord, that you would be a wonderful counselor, that you would move into broken marriages, that you would bind us together with the cords of Christian love. For those praying for their children today, Father, I pray that you would be the God who shows us how to not just love our children, but the God who shows us how to raise our children in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Lord, above all, we're just grateful. Out of all of the things that we could ask for, God, we want to pause just to say thank you. Thank you for being our God, our Redeemer, our friend. Thank you for being the one who provides for us, who keeps us, who covers us. Thank you for being the one who gives peace that passes understanding. Lord, we're praying that you would continue to move in the lives of your children. Give us that sense of urgency to remind us that you are soon to come. Lord, show us creative ways of reaching our community, of sharing the love and light of Jesus Christ, of moving from house to house, from street to street, sharing the power of our Redeemer and the truth that he that shall come will come. And Lord, as we celebrate today the power of liberty in you, I pray for those around the globe that are being persecuted for their beliefs. I pray for those around the world, around the country, and around the world who are struggling because of their beliefs, who are struggling because they hold stalwart, they hold faith, they hold strong to their belief in you. I pray, O Lord, that your holy angels would surround them and uphold them and keep them. I'm praying today, Father, that you would be with our speaker, with Dr. Nixon, as he brings to us a word of truth, that it would not just open our eyes to the realities of this world, but God, that it would break our hearts, crush them into stone, into dust rather, and then from that dust, I pray, O Lord, that you would form hearts of flesh that beat only for you, that beat only for the word, for the power of God, so that we can be those vessels, those conduits of grace in the world around us. Lord, thank you for your power. Thank you for your sustaining power. And I pray that that sustaining power would be with every family right now in our CPC family that is going through this hour of loss. We pray for all of those that are struggling right now to make sense of death. Lord, death doesn't make sense. But you are the giver of eternal life. In fact, you hold the keys to death and the grave. You are able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all we ask or imagine. Soon, God, soon we will experience the resurrection that comes with the second coming of Jesus Christ. And we pray that our hearts would be prepared, that our families would be prepared, that we would see you in peace. Put within us divine purpose, that we would fulfill the mission that you have placed before us. Let our lives be lived out daily. In service to our God. Let your work give us pleasure. Let your ministry give us joy. Let the mission of the cross give us that sense of purpose and completion in our lives. Father, we pray that you would continue to outline your vision for our lives, that daily we would fulfill it. We pray for every person, not just who is watching, but those that will watch. We pray for our global community, our global CPC family, not just those that are watching here in the DMV, but those that are watching in South America, those that are watching in Europe, or those that are watching on the continent of Africa. Wherever they are today, oh God, I pray that you would bless them, that they would sense the power and presence of God, that you would show them your presence in tangible ways, your love in tangible ways today. And then, Father, I pray that when you come, you would save us in your divine kingdom without the loss of one. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
This song I'd like to share with you is an old song. It's probably going to be familiar to many of you. And I decided to share it, my own interpretation of it, because there's something about going back and grabbing things that are old and proven. You know, we live in times that feel really unstable and uncertain. And it's just nice to go back and reconnect with those songs that reaffirm God's sovereign power, the fact that none of what's happening in our lives and in our world is catching God by surprise, and that no matter how it seems, God has the world, and even perhaps more importantly, he has us in the palm of his hand. So I hope the words of this song bless you. It's Come Thou Fount. Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing your grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee. May I still thy goodness prove, while the hope of endless glory fills my heart with joy. I raise my Ebenezer, hither by your help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Constrained to be, and let thy goodness like a fetter bind me closer, Lord, to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Above, prone to wonder, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Oh, here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for your courts above. Seal it for your courts above. Seal it for your courts above.
Happy Sabbath, Community Praise Church family. It's a pleasure to be with you this afternoon. My name is Michael Nixon, and I bring you greetings from Andrews University, where I serve as Vice President for Diversity and Inclusion. I would like to thank your pastors for entrusting me with this opportunity. Pastor L. Rue McKenzie, Pastor Elaine Arthur, my good friend Pastor Garrison Hayes, and your senior pastor Melvin Warfield. I thank God for their leadership of this church during these trying months, and I'm excited about all that God is going to do through them and through you in the future. I would also like to thank your religious liberty leader, attorney Chris Zanotti, for the invitation to serve as your speaker. Without further ado, I'd like to set the table for our time together by reading this. On June 16, 1963, Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel sent the following telegram to then-President John F. Kennedy. I look forward to the privilege of being present at the meeting tomorrow. Likelihood exists that the Negro problem will be like the weather. Everybody talks about it, but nobody does anything about it. Please demand of religious leaders personal involvement, not just solemn declaration. We forfeit the right to worship God as long as we continue to humiliate Negroes. Churches and synagogues have failed. They must repent. Ask of religious leaders to call for national repentance and personal sacrifice. Let religious leaders donate 1 month's salary toward a fund for Negro housing and education. I propose that you, Mr. President, declare a state of moral emergency. A Marshall Plan for aid to Negroes is becoming a necessity. The hour calls for moral grandeur and spiritual audacity. For the next few moments, I will endeavor to speak under the title, Spiritual Audacity. Although Heschel escaped the genocidal wrath of the Nazi regime during the Holocaust, his mother and three of his four sisters, as well as numerous members of his extended family, were killed. Not only did Heschel endure all of those things, he also endured the frustration of seeing people all across Europe and around the world do nothing as millions of Jews and others were killed during the Holocaust. With this context in mind, Heschel saw the inaction and apathy that existed in America in the early 1960s with prophetic clarity. As a result, he committed his life as a scholar, theologian, teacher, and author to consistently shed light on the atrocities being committed against marginalized and oppressed people in general and the American descendants of enslaved persons in particular. Heschel, who was a good friend of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., whose legacy we just celebrated, boldly proclaimed that President Kennedy should declare a state of moral emergency in America due to the atrocities being committed towards Black people. The tragic irony is that recent events in America suggest that our newly installed Biden-Harris presidential administration should make a similar proclamation. Now, I'm not here to deliver a political stump speech, but I'm also not willing to shy away from the realities of the current time that we are living in. In the midst of a global pandemic, we have megachurch pastors all across this country that are continuing to have maskless, super spreader events in the name of worshiping God, all while throwing caution to the wind and endangering the lives of their members. We are in a state of moral emergency. After witnessing the deaths of Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, the shooting of Jason Blake, and countless others, which sparked a global movement of awakening around the issues of white supremacist, anti-Black racism, many professed evangelical Christians refused to utter the words Black Lives Matter, let alone join the movement for racial equity and justice. We are in a state of moral emergency. And how could I fail to mention, on January 6th, not too far from you, in our nation's capital, we witnessed a predominantly white Christian act of domestic terrorism. Flags with the names of Jesus and Trump written in the same size font, nooses, firearms, and anything that could be used as a weapon in the hands of thousands of people motivated by the conspiracy-filled lies of outgoing President Trump and other complicit politicians, attempted to seize the supposed third most secure building in the world. Yes, we are in a state of moral emergency. So the simple question this afternoon on Religious Liberty Day is, how will you, the Community Praise Church family, individuals who profess to be followers of Christ, respond at this critical moment in our history? Heschel's call was for spiritual audacity, that people of faith would stand boldly on the foundation of their moral convictions and call evil and sin by its right name. Heschel understood the words of his friend Dr. King to be true, that we are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be, and you can never be what you ought to be until I am what I ought to be. This is the interrelated structure of reality. On page 534 of Patriarchs and Prophets, Ellen White said this: "We are all woven together in the great web of humanity, and whatever we can do to benefit and uplift others will reflect in blessing upon ourselves. The law of mutual dependence runs through all classes of society." So what does spiritual audacity look like in the life of the Christian? How can we operationalize our call to be the hands and feet of Jesus right now? As should always be our first step, I implore us to look at the life and example of Christ, who laid out the blueprint for spiritual audacity right at the beginning of his earthly ministry. Turn with me in your Bibles to the Gospel of Luke chapter 4, as we will spend the next few moments together examining Christ's encounter with the people in his hometown of Nazareth. Starting in verse 16, the Bible says this: "When Jesus came to the village of Nazareth, his boyhood home, he went as usual to the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read the scriptures. The scroll of Isaiah the prophet was handed to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where this was written: 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come.' He rolled up the scroll, handed it back to the attendant, and sat down. All eyes in the synagogue looked at him intently. Then he began to speak to them, 'The scripture you've just heard has been fulfilled this very day.' Everyone spoke well of him and was amazed by the gracious words that came from his lips. 'How can this be?' they asked. 'Isn't this Joseph's son?' Then Jesus said, 'You will undoubtedly quote me this proverb, "Physician, heal yourself," meaning do miracles here in your hometown like those you did in Capernaum. But I tell you the truth, no prophet is accepted in his own hometown. Certainly there were many needy widows in Israel in Elijah's time when the heavens were closed for 3.5 years and a severe famine devastated the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them. He was sent instead to a foreigner, a widow of Zarephath in the land of Sidon. And many in Israel had leprosy in the time of the prophet Elisha, but the one healed was Naaman, a Syrian." When they heard this, the people in the synagogue were furious. Jumping up, they mobbed Jesus and forced him to the edge of the hill on which the town was built. They intended to push him over the cliff, but he passed right through the crowd and went on his way. There's so much to unpack here, but allow me to submit to you 3 key takeaways that we can glean from the spiritual audacity of Christ that was shown here. If applied and understood, I believe that we will become empowered to share the gospel in a way that we have never done before, that will lead to ourselves and others being liberated from spiritual oppression. The first thing that Christ's example shows us is that spiritual audacity must be embodied on the Sabbath. Spiritual audacity must be embodied on the Sabbath. The Sabbath is not the day for us to set aside issues of justice, equity, and liberty. Christ shows us that the Sabbath is a great day for us to identify with prophetic clarity the current issues and complexities of our day and declare that the gospel has empowered us to work towards tangible solutions to those issues right now. I've grown up celebrating religious liberty days in this church my entire life. Oftentimes, we spend them celebrating the work we have done to secure our right to worship in our buildings on the Sabbath day. Now, the ability to worship together is a great thing, which I miss, and we should celebrate. And I'm sure that you have all missed being together in your building. In fact, I would have loved to be with you all right now in person. But with that being said, I humbly submit to you that if our religious liberty efforts are only positioned towards securing the right of ourselves and others that are within our denomination to have a worship service on the Sabbath, we have missed the true point of Christ's gospel entirely. If the implications of the gospel that Christ is presenting here in the Gospel of Luke on that Sabbath day do not fundamentally alter how we observe the Sabbath, then we are limiting the potential benefits that the true Sabbath observance can unlock for us. Rabbi Heschel understood this from the lens of his Jewish tradition. He wrote this on the Sabbath: "Morally speaking, there is no limit to the concern one must feel for the suffering of human beings. That indifference to evil is worse than evil itself. That in a free society, some are guilty, but all are responsible. On Shabbat, we taste perfection, and then we are called to action, responsible for the well-being of the earth itself and for all those who suffer amidst the brokenness of injustice." Jesus declared on the Sabbath that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come. The question we must ask ourselves each week isn't just how am I bringing myself into the Sabbath, but we should also ask, who am I bringing the Sabbath to? Who is my Sabbath in good news for? What about my Sabbath observance is empowering me to seek the liberation of the oppressed? If the gospel is to be preached on a regular basis in our churches on the Sabbath, there has to be an unapologetic focus on social justice. When you adopt this focus, one of the inevitable questions that will surface will be, is this a social justice church? That's always been an interesting question because to me, that's like asking, is this a book library or is this a food grocery store? We are a church, and because we follow Christ, we are called to pursue justice. If you're still on the fence about this, we need look no further than the Sabbath command as recorded in Deuteronomy chapter 5. After reciting the more familiar parts of the command, God provides a key focus for the children of Israel to keep in the front of their minds as they observe the Sabbath. God says, "Remember that you were once slaves in Egypt, but the Lord your God brought you out with his strong hand and powerful arm. That is why the Lord your God has commanded you to rest on the Sabbath day." God is making sure that they remember the fact that God liberated them from enslavement. It was primarily for that reason that they were commanded to extend Sabbath rest to everyone around them, their families, servants, cattle, land, and any foreigners that were among them. The Sabbath is the day in which they were to remember the liberating power of the gospel. If we are not extending that same liberating power to others, then I caution us to consider that we may not truly be experiencing Sabbath. Now let's be honest with ourselves for a moment. As you look back over your life as a Sabbath-keeping Christian, for those of you who are, have the majority of those Sabbaths felt liberating or restrictive? It's okay, you can be honest. I'll be honest and say that for the majority of my life, the Sabbath has been much more about what I cannot do and should not do, as opposed to being about what I have been called to do. It wasn't until I settled into adulthood that I began to shift my posture towards Sabbath keeping. Regardless of what Sabbath keeping has been like for you up until this point, you, like Jesus, can choose today with spiritual audacity to step into and embrace the liberating power of the Sabbath and Christ's call to work towards liberty, justice, and equity for the others around us. Spiritual audacity must be embodied on the Sabbath. The second thing that Christ's example should teach us is that our spiritual audacity will result in criticism, rejection, and attempts to snuff out our voice. Now, let me be clear, the intent of spiritual audacity should never be intentionally rubbing people the wrong way, but we should understand that it is very likely to do so regardless of our intent. The implications of the gospel are inherently offensive. After Christ declared in verse 21 that the passage from Isaiah that he read had been fulfilled in their presence on that very day, although the Bible indicates that they were impressed by his words, they asked, "How can this be? Isn't this Joseph's son?" The crowd immediately began to seek to discredit his authority to declare the words that he did, bringing up the old questions about the circumstances of his birth. Who is he to tell us what he has come to fulfill? The verses that followed revealed what they truly desired from Jesus. Before they could even make their request of him, Jesus read their hearts. "You will undoubtedly quote me this proverb, 'Physician, heal yourself,' meaning do miracles here in your hometown like those you did in Capernaum. But I tell you the truth, no prophet is accepted in his hometown." They were looking for their hometown hero to fall in line and perform for them. But Jesus' response made the purpose of his ministry clear. He did not come to this earth to conform to the desires of the church. He came to establish his kingdom, which was built on the foundation of seeking and saving the lost. The gospel was never meant to be hoarded. Spiritual audacity calls us to push ourselves and the other members of our church family to extend the healing ministry of Jesus beyond our walls. The sad reality is that when the true gospel is preached, Many in the church will seek to discredit both the message and the messenger. Things got so bad towards the end of our passage in Luke 4 that the Bible says that the members of Jesus' hometown synagogue actually tried to kill him. The gospel indeed is offensive, as the people of Nazareth instantly fulfilled Christ's declaration that no prophet is accepted in their hometown. Just think about this for a moment. Jesus, a Nazareth native, could have chosen anywhere in the then known world to proclaim the beginning of his gospel ministry, the greatest news that this world would ever receive, and it was instantly rejected. A prophecy that they and others had been waiting to be fulfilled for centuries had come to fruition right in front of their very eyes, and not only did they miss it, they tried to kill the bearer of it. The Messiah himself, who came to lay down his life for us, was at risk of losing his life on day one of his public ministry, all because the way that his message was delivered made the hearers of that message uncomfortable. Beloved, we must be weary of a religion that only caters to our comfort. We live in an age today where we are celebrated for shutting down any dissenting opinion that we are confronted with. I'm sure that some will have issues with some of what I've shared this afternoon, and that's okay to a degree. We're all entitled to our own opinions, but it does seem that we have lost the ability to be challenged by messages that make us uncomfortable. We jump to the conclusion that something doesn't have value simply because we disagree with it. Oftentimes, when we are not yet comfortable enough to take decisive action on a matter, the response is to call for more temperate language and messaging. There's an old saying about organizations: when an organization wants to kill something, it creates a committee for it. This surely isn't true of all committees, but during my life in this church, I've seen several good ideas get de-emphasized and snuffed out due to the discomfort of those who held positions of power. Rabbi Heschel's telegram called for President Kennedy to declare a state of moral emergency and to act with spiritual audacity in order to meet the challenges that our country faced. I'll state the obvious and point out that no such declaration was made. The Marshall Plan that Heschel called for American descendants of enslaved persons, containing comprehensive legislation to address their needs, never fully came to fruition. 5 days before Heschel had sent this telegram, Mississippi NAACP leader Medgar Evers had been assassinated, and tragically, a few months later in November, President Kennedy himself was also assassinated. History shows us that those who even consider acknowledging and addressing our state of moral emergency in America often meet that same fate: death. But even though these calls for spiritual audacity and calls for liberty and justice and equity are rarely heeded, we can be sure that the message remains worthy of being delivered. Sure, progress has been made, but many of the same issues at their core that Heschel, MLK, and so many others before us raised their voices to attempt to change are still things that we are wrestling with today. Spiritual audacity likely won't be good for your career advancement. The message that God calls you to declare may lose you some friends. Family members may disown you. You may lose a relationship. The status quo will try to discredit you, but take comfort. That same Jesus who had no place to lay his head as he declared the spiritually audacious gospel of love, justice, liberty, and equity will be with you, even carry you when necessary, every step of the way. Just as the Holy Spirit fell upon Jesus when he declared that the kingdom of heaven is at hand, the Bible promises us in Acts 1:8 that you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So don't be afraid. Get comfortable with criticism, rejection, or even attempts at your very life. Christ is with you, and the message that he has called you to preach will be preached, come what may. Lastly, the spiritual audacity of Christ shown to us in Luke chapter 4 leaves us with one final caution. If we don't pay attention to how our passage ends, we can miss this key detail. The last takeaway that I believe we should learn from the spiritual audacity of Christ, as shown in this passage, is this. Be sure that Jesus hasn't left the room. Let's look again at the last three verses of our passage, starting in verse 28. The Bible says, when they heard this, the people in the synagogue were furious. Jumping up, they mobbed him, meaning Jesus, and forced him to the edge of the hill on which the town was built. They intended to push him over the cliff, but he passed right through the crowd and went on his way. The people were so incensed with Jesus and so committed to throwing him over the edge of the cliff that the Bible says he passed right through them and went on his way. Beloved, how dangerous it can be for us to get so caught up in our opposition to the message of Christ that we fail to see where that message should be taking us next. Or the things that Christ wanted to do in and through us never comes to fruition because in the midst of our distracted anger, Christ quietly goes on his way. Jesus generally doesn't announce his exits, so many churches are convinced that he is still in the building, even though he left years ago. Have mercy. Here was the even deeper tragedy, for the people of Nazareth. If you keep reading in chapter 4, all of those miracles that Christ knew they were hoping for him to perform there in Nazareth take place in other places that Jesus goes. Verse 31 tells that Jesus went on back to Capernaum and taught there in the synagogue every Sabbath day. And the people were amazed by his spiritual audacity and authority. On one of those Sabbaths, he cast out a demon from a man, and later that same day, he went to Simon Peter's home and healed his mother-in-law. The Bible then says people throughout the village brought family members to him, and regardless of what their sickness was, they were all healed with one touch. After a while, the people became so enamored with Jesus that they begged him not to leave, but his response to them is instructive for us at the end of chapter 4. In verse 43, Jesus replied to their urges for him to stay by saying this, I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God in other towns too, because that is why I was sent. The gospel was meant to spark a movement, not to become a stagnant, static monument. I think the message for us here isn't so much that we need to hold tightly onto Jesus in an attempt to keep him where we are. We need to hold tightly onto Jesus so that we can go wherever it is he is going or wherever it is he is sending us. We need to also understand that while Jesus is tarrying with us as he attempted to do in Nazareth, we should be careful not to snuff out his presence. Jesus will move when it is time to move. We must pray to be in tune with his spirit so that we know when it is time to follow. So what does spiritual audacity look like? What does it sound like? I cannot tell each and every one of you with absolute surety what the answers to those questions are, but the starting point for all of us is simply to live out and share the gospel as presented by Jesus with unapologetic power and clarity. Wherever God has placed you, he requires spiritual audacity from you. The times we are living in are too critical for apathy and complacency, but he has not left us to fend for ourselves. He has assured us that wherever it is that our spiritual audacity takes us in our efforts to seek justice, liberty, and equity for those around us, he will be with us. In the words of Heschel, the current hour calls for moral grandeur and spiritual audacity. It is my hope and prayer that you step up to that call, that you're spiritually audacious, that you are a moral agent wherever you are, and that you are a visible manifestation of the presence of the invisible God. Pray with me. Dear God, we thank you so much for this opportunity we've had to share with one another and to dive into your word. God, we're living in strange, complex, and difficult times, but you have called us to be audacious. Now, through the power of your spirit, God, you have called us to speak up and speak out against the different forces of evil that we see manifesting themselves in our world. that we would be visible manifestations of the God who's not quite visible to us just yet. So God, we thank you in advance for empowering us through the power of your Spirit to be spiritually audacious moral agents wherever it is you've placed us. And we'll be confident to give you all the praise, honor, and glory for whatever it is you do through us and with our spiritual audacity. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God bless you.
follow Jesus.
And so today, we are thrilled to be able to celebrate the baptism of Michael and Lisa Marandure. I got that right. And so we're celebrating with them. We're excited about what God has done. And so now Michael is here in the pool. And Michael, because God's hand is on your life, because he told Jeremiah, before I formed you, I knew you. It is our joy to now baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And now, Lisa, we are thrilled because God's hand is on your life, because he has placed within you the Proverbs 31 woman, because you're the apple of his eye, the object of his affection. It's our joy to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. God be the glory for the great things he has done.
Hey, that's all we have for you this week. Huge thank you to VP Michael Nixon Esquire for bringing that powerful word today. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Huge thank you to our guest artist, John Stoddart. And of course, a huge thanks to our CPC band. Of course, a major thank you to our religious liberty leader, Christina Zanotti. Thank you so much for your hard work. Listen, if you want to sign up for Liberty Magazine, you can head over to cpcsda.org/Liberty Mag. There you can sign up for your subscription to this Religious Liberty Magazine. Huge thank you to our CPC leadership team. Pastor Elaine, I'm thinking about you. I'm thinking about you, Andy Russell, for all of your contributions to making this happen on a weekly basis. And last but not least, thank you to you. Thank you for your generous giving. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for commenting and making this experience special with your presence. We are so thankful for all of you. Listen, as you go, we pray that you heard something that sparked something that will allow you to share something with someone about Jesus, that you'll be able to tell someone about the love of our God as you go. We'll see you right back here next week. Until then, God bless you and happy Sabbath.
Say, as you go,
as you go.
Wonderful Sabbath. Take care.
Listen while you still can hear the Master's call. The Master's calling. Bow down while your knees still bend. Call.